We're back! Oh, it's time. You know what time it is. It's time to learn. All right, so we're gonna go ahead and review the Brom game from today. That's before we get into this. Come look at my face. Come talk to my face. We had a good game. We had a good series of games today. Some wins and losses. You know, it wasn't like a huge win streak or anything like that, but. Overall, I was feeling pretty good. I think we were playing all right today. The drill definitely helped out a little bit. At the start of the day, the practice game, made me feel good. And we got in the zone. We were doing good today. I was feeling pretty all right with my play. So we're going to review the last game of the day, a game in which I did particularly well. I had one of those flashy score lines. It wasn't perfect, as we can see here. I did have the one death. So not the perfect game, but even in that, I really did make some errors, especially on in the early game. There were a lot of opportunities, I think, that I could have had and made the most out of there. So we're going to go ahead and review this game, see what we can learn. And since I haven't played Brom in a while, it's just nice to give myself some time to think about Brom, think about how his kit works, what opportunities that were there, what opportunities were missed. I also first picked him in this matchup, and as you can see, I didn't really pick too many things that I could block with Brom. So I didn't feel that great about playing the Brom in this composition. There were definitely some auto attackers that came around afterwards. I mean, Lucian was the only one who was showing when I picked Brom, so seeing the Gnar and the J4 come in certainly made me feel a lot better about that. But we're going to go ahead and watch the review for that game. Let me make sure, just do a quick testeroni here in the pepperino to make sure that you guys today will actually be able to properly see the drawing on the screen tool. Let's see, is this showing up? No, it's not. So what we do is we open up this, we go here, you guys see little squares, then we go back and yeah, there we go. Woo! All right, perfect. So we're gonna go ahead and hop on in here. Let's get this loading. So like I said, it was a pretty good Brom game for us overall. We had definitely had some good plays by the end. We were doing a good job with here we go, hold on. Just trying to Oh, goodness gracious. Everything's going crazy. There we go. Perfect. Okay, so, you know, we were having some okay plays. It wasn't too crazy of a game. There was a game with a crazy start. I believe that was Jana that game, where there was like an invade, and then I chased people around the map. I wasn't down in bot lane again until my ADC was level 3. But because of that, I actually made a huge difference around the map. And we started off a lot better that game because of that. So here's something right off the bat. I'm glad I was able to dodge at least in queue. Also, I'm glad he didn't position it a little bit differently. I was looking for the dodge there, so I actually do feel like I dodged that a little bit. Not to give myself too much credit there. Because, you know, it was team effort. Lee Sin also had to miss it. But, you know, I felt okay about that. I did miss the opportunity to not flash. But, you know, I think I reacted pretty good there. One of the things we mentioned yesterday was, or in last episode was, I need to be more liberal about letting go of my summoner spells when I know that I need to. Like, I can recognize it in my mind, I can feel it in my bones, but I still won't use it because I'm greedy. I'm greedy to try and preserve that cooldown, and I just shouldn't. I should just use the cooldown. And I didn't hesitate there, and luckily I was able to dodge the Lee Sin Q. So everything works out fine. I'm able to go slam down the pink ward in my favorite brush there. We have a pretty good leash with Lush. to Jarvan, and we're off to lane here. I believe I pinged out that they started at blue. Once we saw that they got here late. No, I think this might have been the one game I didn't do that. I was too focused on actually getting my Targons stacks off my relic shield stacks, rather. Get my relic shield stacks off. Okay, let's already go back in. Let's analyze that trade right there. So, okay, Lucian's got his Q double shot. So his Q's on cooldown, and Nautilus was walking back. It would it have been possible to get a Q off on him for me, even there? Let's already check. Let's see if we already could have made a bit better of a play there. Because I know minions were still around. Let's see. So I went for my stack. Right here I could have queued him. Point blank. He's too far forward. Caitlyn. So the distance between Caitlyn and him is enough that where even though she's Caitlyn, she has like the longest just auto attack range, I think in the game. I might be wrong about that, but if not, she's certainly one of the highest. This is still, actually, it's not even, the character model is like there. So this is quite a large distance between them. So even with that huge range advantage she has, a point blank Q to the face right here starts that stack. Then I could follow it up with an auto, he could auto. So he turns immediately. He starts walking, he probably realizes, whoa, I'm way too far forward and Caitlyn's back. So, if I had gotten the Q, I wouldn't have been able to auto, but we would have gotten the two shots off, and it would have been a little bit of free damage. So maybe that was a missed opportunity there. Nothing too huge off the start. I was thinking about that already in game, so I was like, okay, I'm going to walk forward, see if I can get the stack off. If not, I'm going to try and start the passive onto Nautilus just to get that free damage. Lucian is able to proc it, so I see that he's able to proc it, and I think, okay, you know what, good enough, this is the good trade, we've won here. Caitlyn's already used her ability, the only thing she can do now is auto attack. So if I go in and try and auto the tank as a tank versus her autoing me, we're not going to win that trade, so I do decide to back off here. So that's pretty good. Unfortunately, she still gets one more shot off, and I think that was a headshot or crit. But, you know, that's fine. We still won the trade. Unfortunately, there's her range coming in again. I might have been able to get a Q off on Nautilus here. Let's see, because I think he walked in front of his minion, or, like, they died. Yeah, right here. Okay, so I actually can't, because I'm blocked. He's actually doing a really risky play by going in front of these minions, but he's weaving in a really effective way. So the opportunity cost, right? If he goes this way, any hook that he tries to do is blocked by this minion right here. So he can only start hooking once he arrives here. Whereas if he goes this way, he has a nice hook shot on Lucian anytime he can get around this minion. So this may seem like a narrow gap, but once he steps up here, this entire range is all hookable. And that he just has to, his hook's hitbox is pretty generous, so he just has to be able to get a proper angle by going this way. That will give him a different view, so he can actually go even further back here, and this will now be included in the hitbox, whereas right now, this is the furthest that's out there. So he's making the correct play, I think, to do that, because he's got this minion to play in between of for me and him. So I can't queue him right now to start my stacks, because what Lucian could do is if I could just queue him, if this minion weren't here, I could just queue him and Lucian would attack him and we'd almost get the stun off immediately. So that would be a great trade for us, but I have to actually start it. So since I can't do that, and that minion was blocking the whole time, this is the first time I've really had a shot, but it wasn't clear that the minion was going to aggro that direction. So I try and clear it with the Targons, or the Relic Shield, keep saying Targons, the Relic Shield, to get it out of the way so I have a clear shot, but by then he's already backed off. So I think that wasn't too bad of a play. That was largely alright. And right now we're just going to back off here. It seems like we've lost a little bit of initiative in the lane. I do the laugh taunt because I'm confident. Now, that was a little cocky because this minion wrapped behind me, but I'm ready to just dodge away. I'm sitting there just trying to bait out a hook. This is something that I've taken to not too long ago. I started doing this, and I'm actually considering changing this. I've got one, the laugh, not the taunt, but the laugh emote, binded to one of the mouse buttons that I have on the side of my mouse. I've been thinking about rebinding that to instead be a trinket or like an active item. But for opportunities like that, it might make the enemy play a little bit more aggressively than they normally would. And if there's no real opportunity cost to that, because he's going to hook in the tank and then Caitlyn might start fighting, there might be a skirmish, but I think we would trade overall of evenly there because I would be able to hook or cue him back. Now that they're level 2, I shouldn't be doing anything like that, but little things like that to try and put the enemy off kilter is definitely stuff I try and take advantage of when I have the chance. So I see the ward, so I back away. Unfortunately, Caitlyn range is insane, and she gets a crit off on me. This is great to see, so I'll compliment them in chat. Go back to lane here. I'm looking for the... just to be here and back up Lucian. I'm pretty sure I started... Yeah, I got my W second. Still spamming out that lap. Unfortunately, I can't get the relic shield off, so those were two autos that I probably didn't have to take, right? So let's look. That's how much longer. I'm nowhere near getting that relic shield off. That one was a punish for the like emote spam to try and put him off kilter. But I probably would have been walking just back and forth in that spot anyway. That's a good sidestep by me to dodge the Q. But right here again, I think my brain just went into, oh, low cannon minion. I'm going to hit that with my shield, get the stack off. But I wasn't managing my stacks properly, so I didn't have one up in time. So instead, what I should have done, instead of pathing around here to try and get the theoretical stack off, I should have just pathed here and hung back with Lucian and let Lucian get his last hit. Because he winds up having to do that anyway. And that's fine. But I just took a free shot there that I didn't have to take. So that's a pretty bad start. Wasn't really able to dodge that one. So whenever I see him go for a piercing light, I need to just be looking to try and get my Q out as quickly as possible so he can get the double shot off, and then we can be at three stacks. And you see me trying to move forward here, and now I've got a pretty good a pretty good line of vision there. But she's walking right back into the minions. Nautilus is kind of walking in front. So I decided to say, okay, you know what, Nautilus, if you're going to tank it, I am going to throw it out on you anyway. I was confident that we could get the stun off on him. So I was hoping that I would be able to get that out before he could hook me. Unfortunately, one, they hit level 3 when that happens. So this is just really... really bad because we are under-leveled compared to them right now. And like you can see the experience bar, that's the purple bar right here. We're both really close to leveling. We're going to get it off this wave too. But they push the wave first, so they've got the level 3 potential here, and I don't. So this is actually a horrible trade, I think. Even if we started off with my passive, now we don't really have anywhere to go. Caitlyn, it looks like she's got her... she doesn't have her next stack for her headshot. But, like, I'm kind of creep-blocked against the wall. This stun is almost over. And, like, I'm out of abilities. I can jump to Lucian if things get bad. Which I think I actually have to here. Yeah, I do. Even though it's only that far. Because Caitlyn is throwing down the trap, you can't really see it perfectly, but there's a trap that Caitlyn threw right there. If I tried to walk this way, that trap would trigger, and then she would get the headshot, I would be rooted, Nautilus would be able to root me with his auto attack, and the passive of that is to make them rooted for a short duration of time. So they could chain that CC, then Nautilus could use his E to slow me, because now they're both level 3, remember? And since I'm level 2, I'm far less tanky, so I'm going to take a whole bunch of damage. So the only option to do is what I exactly do here, where I use my W, I get to Lucian, and I avoid that situation, which is good. But again, we shouldn't have been in this situation in the first place, because this, I think, was probably just a bad trade. Overall, you see we're coming out of it a bit behind. It's best to compare that to what our health bars were before that. But I would venture, I guess, that we lost that trade pretty substantially. We got a good chunk of chip damage onto Nautilus, but he's the tank. He's fine. He's perfectly happy to take damage like that in exchange for his ADC to put out damage onto us. So I don't think that was right. Unfortunately, I still take a bit more damage here. And once the trade is complete, you see the full damage that's been done. It's not even close. That was just a really bad trade. After, like, at this point, I think I even said to chat, I was like, ooh, yeah, we didn't win that one. I shouldn't have gone in on that. That was pretty bad. So I hang out. I'm just trying to get the the relic shield. I keep saying targons. That's what it upgrades into. I'm trying to get the relic shield stacks off on anything. I'm not optimizing it. I'll take a caster just because I want that heal. I want to try and get my HP up as much as possible because I do the start where I have the pink ward. You hear that Braum laugh of me taunting again. Because I start with the pink ward, I only have one biscuit. So even though we're the same into our health pots being used, he has two left over and I have none because mine are sitting there on the map. Which I stand by, I think is the right choice. If you're going support, I would definitely start with the one health pot or biscuit if you have the mastery upgrade and the one red ward so you can get that extra vision control on the map and maybe prevent a gank from going off or enable a gank to go off or counter gank even around this part of the map. And it really helps in mid. That's why I always try and use these bushes here because mid lane just, they need the help. If you can help mid lane early, that'll either freeze them up to play aggressively if they're an aggressive mid laner, or if they're somebody who needs to really wait till they hit six and then they can start unloading. It enables them to play a little bit more safely, cheat towards one side. As you can see, Lux is really cheating heavily towards that side because she has so much vision on the map, especially since J4 has the Scuttle Crab. That side of the map is almost entirely safe. The only thing that she doesn't know is once you enter the actual physical jungle itself. So, you know, it enables that, and it may put me a little bit behind, but I shouldn't be taking this much damage in the first place. That last trade, if we go back to how healthy I was before that entire trade happened, I think it happened... Okay, one more. So, I mean, you see, I'm fine. I'm getting the last little bit of my health off, so I took a little damage there that could have been avoided, probably. But this is fine. This is perfectly... allowable amount of health points out. I was just greedy seeing that Lucian got his Lightslinger out, so I really wanted to get that passive rolling with his passive, make use of that synergy, but out of the thirst to do that, I made a poor judgment call and went in on an inopportune time. So now we have to really play defensively. I have to hug this turret super hard and just wait for the minions to crash against it before I can even do anything. So again, I'm trying to throw out the bait. This time he actually goes for it. He doesn't actually hit me, he hits Lucian, which is probably the better target for them regardless. But we do luckily make it out alive. It was really close. Lucian's going back, so I just intentionally step on that trap. I'm thinking, okay, he's gonna try and hook me here, so I was prepared to get out of the way. I do, he eats a turret shot for it, fine. Everything sort of comes out in the wash. At the end, once Caitlyn gets that last minion, they decide to go back. They're really far ahead right now. Lucian's going to make it back with boots and a longsword. And Caitlyn, especially because she's stayed for another wave after that, she's going to have so much more gold to spend. She'll probably come back with a BF sword, which... A longsword is 10 attack damage. A BF sword is around 40, I think. 40 or 50. Let's see if she gets it. She might also be going for Blade of the Rune King, so she might go a different build on No, she's going for the crit build, but she's going to get the pickaxe instead. Just didn't have quite enough gold. I think it's like 40 or 50 might be the amount of minions you need. Maybe that's what I was thinking of. Somebody in chat will know that off the top of their head. but so she's going to come back with a like 15% or 15 flat attack damage advantage over our Lucian. So all of these trades now going forward are going to be that much worse for us. We can already see, like, that's a... I'm tanky Braum. I've come back with an upgraded Targon, so I've got a lot of health. And she's doing just as much damage as she did before. And again, I think that was probably some needless tanking, so... I think at this point in the actual live chat, or when we were live streaming... I was talking to Chad. I was like, you know, I don't know who I play aggressively forward like that, and it works, but it's certainly not Braum, so I need to stop playing that way. So, my playstyle shifts pretty heavily here, and I even take that jump, you know, it's point blank, just because I need to get as far as possible. Unfortunately, Caitlyn gets a really good trap off on me, but I'm able to start the passive on both of them, so... We get a decent trade there. We don't end up getting the kill, and they do get J4, but we protect ourselves from dying as well. And that could have been a lot worse, you know? Very easily, if they weren't stunned, that could have been that could have been all three of us dying. That could have been at least Lucian dying along with him. So getting the stun off there was pretty critical, and I think I did an okay job of... when you're in the thick of it, you know who you queue, and then auto-attack somebody else so you start the stacks on both. Be aware of what the stacks are on both of them, so you can, if they're getting close, this was a good minion delivery to him. So if they're getting close, you can throw your auto-attack to them instead and get a little extra damage. Now I'm trying to juke out the hook here. Unfortunately, it didn't quite work, but... he does go in for the hook finally a little bit later. So let's actually go back, because I've already seen a couple mistakes in this play so far. So I'm going to pause right here. So this is when I first turn. You can see from the nice little particle effect from my shield there. I turn because I'm anticipating Nautilus hook goes out in a straight line. So if I had kept walking in this direction, or I guess that's not even quite... an accurate line there. Ah, where's my clear? There we go. So if I had been walking from here and gone in a straight direction, Nautilus could have thrown out his hook right here, and it would have been easiest hook of his life to hit on me. Now, I'm not necessarily the highest priority target here. One, I'm level 5 and Lucian is level 4. So just from... incidentally, how we backed, or him being out trying to place a ward and a minion died, something like that. I've leveled a little bit faster than he has, so one, for that reason, but also because I'm Braum. I build a bit tankier than he does. You can see each of these little lines represents 100 hit points. So even though we're about the same percentage of our health, I've got a whole bunch of those little lines, whereas he only has 4 or 5. So they definitely want to get Lucian if possible. At this point, I probably would have just gone after me and got what free damage I could. But they have Lee Sin coming. You can see on the mini-map here. You can't quite... You can see his foot. See his foot right there on the mini-map here. And I just covered him up. Whatever. Lee Sin, you can see he's right there. He's going to be coming in. So Nautilus wants to save that hook for when the dive happens. They might already be thinking they're going to need a dive. Lee Sin is probably just going to come, not even like that, maybe more straight like this, to see, okay, let's force Lucian back. Let's try and see if we can make something happen off of Braum. So I'm cheating back this way right now to try and dodge this hook. Because I think, okay, if I get hooked, I'll be here. Probably Lee Sin will be about here by the time that's over. But then Nautilus autos me. and I have to wait for that route duration to end. Lee Sen's probably about here when that's over, and I can start moving again. But at that point, Nautilus has his E up, and his E will slow me. So as I'm running from here, I'm going to be going very slowly. It'll make it very easy for Lee Sin to hit his Q, especially since Lee Sin will be about here at that time. This is a pretty easy Q to hit. The missile speed for Lee Sin's Q is pretty fast. So, you know, I don't want to burn the flash if I don't have to. This goes back to something, again, we said earlier in the last episode, to just be ready to burn the flash if necessary. I still think it's too early, but if I wind up in this position I've laid out, I'm going to have to flash that Lee Sin Q. Because I'm slowed, I'll have no cooldowns, there's nothing I can do. I just got to use it. So I want to avoid that if possible, so that's what this juke is about. Though it seems kind of strange that I'm kind of keeping myself in the danger zone over here, I would qualify anything probably past this line as the danger zone. So even though I'm not running out of it as quickly as possible, I'm trying to juke around in the danger zone to get past some of that CC, because if Nautilus just weren't here, or if he was a different champion that just didn't have crowd control abilities, I would probably be okay to just walk straight back to my turret and be safe. So since he's not, I have to try and juke around a little bit, and we'll see here. I even stay going that direction a little bit further. I go here because, okay, I'm all the way against the wall. I gotta move because Lee Sin's here and he's coming for me. I gotta get to my turret quick. So I start running. Again, I try and juke one more time. Now, unfortunately, I just end up walking into his auto attack. But let's examine why this happens, right? I jump back a lot further than I thought that would take me. Let's hold on here. So, this is where the first juke happens. I'm going, and now here I juke. Again, this is, now that Lee Sin's in a bit more of a determined position, I would say the danger zone is about here, right? So, again, instead of going out of the danger zone, I'm kind of juking around in it. This one is a lot less defendable for a couple reasons. One, because of exactly what happens, right? Nautilus just doesn't even try and hook. He just autos me, and I'm stunned. So that's a definite mistake. That's a definite error. Another reason it's an error is because, unlike the first time where I was here, I believe, and I had a sizable amount of room to juke, I'm starting here. I've only got about that much room to juke. That's not that much, especially with Nautilus's hook. The hitbox on that is pretty generous. So I don't think I could have juked away, unless if he was predicting a flash and threw it all the way out there. But I'm not in such a desperate position that I would flash immediately at this point. Maybe if I juke like this and then am in an even worse spot, I have to flash. Which is why I don't think I should be juking like that. I think I should, this time, though the first time it was a valiant attempt to juke, and I think probably feeling that made it go to my head a little bit, so I tried to do it again, even though it was the inopportune time to do that. So this time I should have just keep running. Even if Lee Sin can hit a pretty easy Q on me, and then Nautilus can hook me, all largely, it's debatable, but I'm almost certain I would be within range of the turret when all that would happen. And Lucian would get some free shots off as well. So I probably wouldn't die. They probably would take some damage. That would probably be fine. Instead, I juke around here. Now, it is good of me to, as soon as I see that he's just going to auto-attack me and I'm just pinned against the wall, there's nothing I can do, to hit him right back. Because this will start the passive on him. Three more shots, and he's stunned. So that'll buy me a little bit more time. This isn't to be aggressive onto him, even though he does have, for Nautilus, a fairly small amount of health. It is good to get that stun out, so it'll at least prevent that source of damage from hitting me too hard. You can see in the minimap, Caitlyn is still all the way out in these minions, so she's not going to be a threat during this fight. And luckily for me, this Lee Sin Just really wants to get damage in on dilution. So he throws out his Q there. This is what saves me. I think if Lee Sin had instead Q'd me during this engagement, he could have landed onto me and gotten a lot of free damage on me. And there wouldn't have been much either myself or Lucian could have done to stop it. Or to trade back even. But instead, he goes for this fight and the skirmish on dilution. So that saved me. Nonetheless, this was the wrong play to do. Even though I wasn't punished in this scenario because Lee Sin went on dilution, it was still the wrong play to do. And it could have cost us very dearly there. That could, if Caitlyn were to flash forward and become relevant in this fight, and if Lee Sin were focusing me, if they chained some CC together, it is possible that I could have died there. See, it seems unlikely. It seems very unlikely, especially because I have my flash. I have my exhaust. Lucian has his heal. But I definitely would have had to burn summoners there. There's no question about that. Just because it's possible that I would die if I didn't. So I would have had to burn summoners almost instantly. As soon as I could use them again, I would have had to flash away. So let's view what actually winds up happening, though. Because again, We're lucky boy this game, and Lee Sin's not going after us. He's going for that Lucian damage. So, even though that slow hits me, Lucian's now in range for me to jump to. We largely trade evenly there, me and Nautilus, because neither of us does really any damage. And, yeah, seems alright. Unfortunately, Nautilus finds his money hook. He does. Luckily for us, Lee Sin had already W'd Nautilus to give him a little bit of extra shielding, as you see right there. That's from the Lee Sin W still happening around him. But this is a bad decision from Nautilus. Even though he gets it past the minions because of the angle he had, this is bad for a couple reasons. One, Nautilus has already used his E, so he has less follow-up CC. Two, Lee Sin's Q is still on cooldown from when he just threw a point blank at Lucian's face. And his W's on cooldown, so he can't jump to support. Either with his Q or his W, he can't jump into support. And Caitlyn is pretty much out of range. She's about to step into it here, and for Caitlyn, like, she might already be in range. Because she's Caitlyn. But he's put himself in a lot of danger here. He's already got one tick of my passive up on him, and now he's definitely taking turret shots here. So he's decidedly gone beyond that line of the danger zone for them. So the correct thing for me to do here is just immediately turn and try and punish that, right? Try and get that stun off as quickly as possible. I know Lucian's going to be doing the same thing, just trying to get his auto attacks out there as quickly as possible. And if we can get the stun off while he's still in range of the turret, before he has time to retreat, then he's going to, all of a sudden, the tables will be turned. He'll have to flash. Caitlyn will have to use heal for him. Something like that. And that will be a decisively favorable trade for us. So, what do I do here? I walk away. Now, I don't walk away for long. And I do Q pretty quickly after. But again, let's go back. Hang with me as we go through the whole scenario again here. But I think this is a really important point to emphasize, so bear with me. As soon as it turns around, right? That hitbox, right? I'm telling you, it's generous. Right here. This is where I am right now. At this point, I've seen him land that. Right here, I need to immediately cue Nautilus. He's already got the one stack. I need to cue him immediately and start walking that direction to get auto attacks off on him. That is what I need to do. This is where I was. Oh, God, that's so far. Oh, man. Okay. So, I was here. I walked all the way to here. I mean, look at that, you guys. Look at that. That is such a large amount. When we're talking about a fight like this, where it's this early levels, very close range. If I had instead walked from here, what is that distance? I'm going to use my finger to measure on the monitor. That's where that measures out to. I would be in range of Nautilus to have been just auto-attacking him to get my passive stacking, you know? I would be auto-attacking him to get my passive stacking. I would be in position already to block Caitlyn's ultimate, which I'm not right now. I'm far out of position. I got to do something to get myself there. Flash, jump to Lucian, something. I got to use an ability of mine to get in range to block that. And instead, in all that time, my passive stacks have completely fallen off Nautilus. So we have to start from square one. We don't have the one stack already happening. And if instead I had used that Q immediately from this point, hit him, he would be at two stacks. And then I could have walked to him and autoed him again. With no help from Lucian, no autos from Lucian counted, he would be at three stacks about to be stunned right here. Three stacks. I could stun him under turret and he would die. That's not enough health. If you get stunned by Braum under turret and Lucian isn't dead during all this, Lucian gets like one or two autos on you, you die. You die. Or you gotta flash. You gotta flash. Caitlyn's gotta use heal on you. And again, at an early stage of the game, if we can get that without having to answer with summoners of our own, that's nearly as good for us as dying. The only thing better for us than that would be you dying. So, this is a big error. And at this point, I realize it. So I try and, as quickly as possible, compensate for that and throw out my Q. And it's, we get the stack started. Lucian uses an ability. I'm not able to block. This is, again, look at that. Look at that damage. Look at that damage. It even already fell off a little bit off the top. But that was about two-thirds of Lucian's current health at the time. So Lucian's going to get his two autos off, sure, on Nautilus. Man, this was a lot closer than I recall. But he had to burn heal there. If I was there standing in front of him, because of, again, the distance difference that we laid out before, where if I had, instead of going this way, I had gone this way, I could have used my health bar to block that projectile from Caitlyn, and it would hit me, and I would be fine, because I got plenty of health to spare at that point. So, unfortunately, it hits Lucian, so he has to use his heal. So we're already one summoner spell behind at that point. See right there, like, I'm not sure if I had walked further this way, I could have blocked that. It's possible. And I try to come in for it at the very end with my shield. I'm just too slow on that. I'm too slow on that for a number of reasons. Oh boy, man. We really should analyze them. I know, we're gonna take forever on this first engagement, you guys, but you know I take forever in lane. Laning phase is so important. We gotta analyze this. We're gonna slow it down. So it's even more painful because it was during the dash, so like that's really unfortunate. Right now, my E's up, it's not on cooldown. I need to get to him. Unfortunately my W still is. Remember, these cooldowns are bugged right now in the replay client. But my E isn't. So I gotta get there. I should be walking like this, right? I'm walking towards Nautilus. Now, because he went into turret range, remember, he's taking these turret shots. That's where all this damage comes from. That's where all that damage came from. Now, after taking the ultimate from Caitlyn, Lucian's gotta burn his heal. Remember, we are way out leveled here. I'm 5, he's 4. But not as 5. Kate is 6. And Lee Sin is 5. We're out, man. We're out leveled. The only thing we've got working for us is that their tank happens to not have very much health right now because he tanked turret shots. He tanked 2 turret shots. But we're going to be down a heal because Lucian realizes how low he is. He's got a heal. And it gives him the move speed to try and chase down Nautilus. He sees that this is an opportunity for a kill here. Nautilus, seeing that Nautilus is really low and might have that passive proc, Caitlin answers with a heal of her own. Nautilus also flashes away. Those happen so quickly, one after another. They probably didn't mean to do both of those. But great. That right there is, a safe Nautilus. So we can't get him anymore, so we need to back off. But two, that's a trade in our favor. Right now. We can take that and run. That Nautilus, Flash, and that Caitlin heal. That's us. We spent one Lucian heal. That's it. We got one free summoner out of that exchange. Even though I made that many mistakes. Even though I didn't tank the... Imagine if I had... This is what I'm saying. This could have been a kill, right? This could have been a kill for us if I had played this better. If I had made Nautilus come in deeper because I hadn't juked around. When Nautilus did come in deeper, I had reacted properly and it proc'd the stun, so he would have taken that one extra turret shot. Even with the heal and the flash, that one extra turret shot is his life, and he's dead. And that turret shot follows you if you flash. So he's still gone. So that would have been a kill for us. And Lucian might not have had to use his heal if I had tanked, like, Caitlyn's ult for me is, like, that much. You know? Lucian could still have his heal. That could have been... two free summoners and a kill for us. And we would have spent nothing for it. But just hanging out in lane, making good plays. All that on top of it happening while we're getting ganked. When it's 3v2 against us. If we could have made that happen, that would have been so good. It would have used their jungler's time. It would have soaked up two of their summoner spells for nothing. And it would have got us a kill. That would have been incredible. I would be patting myself. I would be taking as much time right now to break down how awesome I am instead. Because that would have been an incredible play. But I didn't make that play. So instead we're analyzing what could have been. So I think the best way to summarize that is... what's a term I could use to describe that? Twitch chat, help me out. I would say positional awareness would be a good way to describe that. Because Nautilus was out of position. I put myself out of position. I didn't reposition properly. And all that wound up costing us a kill and a summoner spell. And, you know, that's just out of positional awareness alone. So, we'll keep that in mind. See maybe if that becomes the theme of today's episode, positional awareness. So, after all this happens, Lee Sin, and so my shield's still up, so Caitlyn's auto attack can't hit Lucian. Lee Sin's trying to put down damage, but my shield's up, so I'm taking reduced damage, so that's fine. I'm willing to just walk forward through all that and start the stacks onto Caitlyn. Lucian gets his first auto attack on Caitlyn. Now my shield has expired and isn't going to be up for the rest of this. But this isn't bugged. My W is actually off cooldown. So if I need to retreat, I can jump away. Nautilus isn't going to be coming back. He might, because by the time he comes back, this passive's gone. But that's such a small amount of health, it's really risky for him to come back, even in the middle of a gank. These two people have so much health. They shouldn't need him, so he should just book it and be fine. Caitlyn might get stunned here, though. So I'm not going to jump to him and retreat, especially because he's standing by a Caitlyn trap that she just threw down. So if I jump to him, I might accidentally step on the trap, so let's not do that. but you see, I kind of step back a little bit, but I immediately start walking forward again because the next time my auto's up, which it comes up right there, I'm still in range. So that was the perfect amount of juking back. That was, as a melee champion, everyone understands this as a range champion. How to kite, right? When somebody's, if you're here and they're there, you auto attack them, they move to here while you auto attack them. Then you move to here, they match you, but by the time you're here, your auto attacks up again. So you get another auto on them. They get this much closer. But then you get to match them moving again. They have to move in these tiny increments. And that's... you get that kite motion, right? And you get a whole bunch of free damage out of that while they can't do anything. It's a lot smaller margins when you're a melee champion, but that's an example of it right there in the play I made, where I kind of walked back a little bit, and then I stuck with her and followed her, because the range, this is the maximum range on my auto attack. So I'm actually, I think that's actually pretty solid play there, for that aspect at least. And I put her at 3 shots. It's completely understandable for Lucian to not want to be around here to try and get that last proc on her, to proc the stun. Because he's so low, he just burned his heal. I don't know why it's not showing on the summoner spell, but his heal is down right now. Trust me, he used it. You saw it. But Lee Sin is... we don't know if he has his flash up. We're going to assume he does. We don't know how close to 6 he is. We're going to assume he's not about to just level off that minion, but you never know. Caitlyn, we know she doesn't have like almost any abilities at her availability right now, but she still does a lot of damage. Remember, we're behind in this fight. She has the pickaxe. He has the longsword, right? So we're not looking to try and take a fight. We don't have to... just for the sake of fighting. We need to be sure that we're going to win these fights. So it's perfectly understandable for Lucian to retreat here. So I get this third proc off just to show her who's boss and make proper use out of my range. But as soon as I get this auto attack off, she's going to be out of my range and she can now kite me because she's a ranged champion and I'm not. So as a melee champion, I have a very tight range around me where I can auto attack. And this is about as far as it gets. So I need to immediately start running. So I get that off. It looks like she actually stops to auto me there to try and kite back. Which is, you know, it's fine. If I were her, I'd be focused on running because of what you guys probably saw at the top of the screen and might have been seen on the mini-map here. Jarvan has arrived. Woo! Cavalry's here! So that's why this play winds up being okay for us. Because Jarvan answered. Jarvan counter ganks the Lee Sin. He answers this gank. And although this Nautilus should already be dead, although Lucian should already have his heal, or should still have his heal off cooldown, which again, he doesn't because this is bugged. Jarvan's coming in to try and make this play. And to see, oh wow, Caitlyn's almost about to get stunned. I have all my cooldowns available. I'm ready to kill her. and he's actually level 6. So he changes the entire dynamic of this fight. Because this level 6 doesn't mean much anymore. Because her ultimate's done. And Lee Sin doesn't have 6 to match. So he's coming in. Lucian, now that she's this far out of position with the Jarvan coming in. Even though Lucian's low. Even though he doesn't have the heal. Theoretically, they could both flash and start beating his face in, but it's unlikely that that would work out well for them. They might get him and then both die. And they could probably still make it out of here. They're hoping, right? Especially because Nautilus might be able to help out with their retreat path. He might not want to hook and dive right in and die himself, but he might be able to throw out an E-slow people. So they're just trying to get out of here alive. They're trying to prevent this stun at all, if all possible, right? That's another reason why the double flash in probably wouldn't work. Because Kate would be insta-stunned. Lee Sin would take 4 procs to actually stack up before it goes off. But that might even happen too. So his retreat path might be cut off as well. So we see Jarvan already throwing out his spear. He's going to use it to gap close in. He lands the knockup. He procs the stun. She's done. She's gone. She flashes. He can still auto-attack her. Great. Right now, there's my Q. Landed onto Lee Sin. Good. I wasn't sure I did. Whoa, that was a jump. But so, okay. Lee Sin, what happened there was Lee Sin ward hopped here. And then seeing the flash from Lucian, knew that that stun was going to get propped. So he flashed himself. So that's alright. That's alright. I wasn't sure if we wanted to keep going, so I to give the option, I stepped further forward than necessary, and the reason for that was I was thinking, one, if we do go, I want to be there to support them, But also, too, there's not much risk here. Because after this huge skirmish, I'm going back to base. So I have effectively, as long as it doesn't hit zero, my health means nothing right now. As long as it's one or above, it's all the same to me. Because I'm about to go to back to base and regen to full anyway. So I take the turret shot for free. That's fine. I throw out some laughs just to rub it in. Because, like I said, I felt the mistakes I was making in-game, so I know I didn't play that well, and I know that should have gone better for us. But even with that, we end up getting the kill on Caitlyn, and it's unanswered. None of us died. So, that's great. Xerath is coming in here for the gank. Now, we don't know where he is on the map, but we don't see him quite yet, right? Now we can tell. Because that... you just hear me spamming that laugh emote. Because that charge comes out of the fog of war, right? I think his character model is still in the brush, but we see this. So we got a book. We got to get out of here. And Nautilus has the right idea. Even though they're low, like you see, Nautilus was the most low. I mean, aside from Caitlyn, who actually died, Nautilus was the first one to get that low and be like, whoa, I got to get out of here. So now that Nautilus is back, that should be kind of a sign to us that something's up. And I didn't pick up on that. That could have been a situation where I read them a little bit better. But nonetheless, he lands that. That's unfortunate. But Jarvan does cancel his back quickly enough, his recall. So he's fine. And it's entirely possible that they didn't know he was still around. So he's going to try and hang in this brush. I just need to keep Lucian alive. I have my W. And I think this is still on cooldown, but not by much. So I can jump to Lucian, give him that additional magic resistance, try and tank the stun that Xerath throws out, and then start my passive onto Xerath. So I'm thinking, okay, how do I get this Q onto Xerath? Now that's... Xerath's going to hit that, but here's the stun coming out, right? Luckily, we're just lucky. I didn't... Let me make sure before I grief myself too hard here. I want to, now that this is reset, let me check my abilities. Yeah, it looks like they're all up here. Yeah, so they're definitely all available right now. So I'm not helping out the solution. I don't want to W to him and jump into that and take free damage myself. As soon as it happened, though, I should have jumped in front of them to dodge it. This is just immaculate play by the Lucian. Because that circle that happened first, that Lucian did get hit by, also slows him. So I'd have dodged this. This is not only a stun, but like that's plenty of damage to kill him when he's that low. So just immaculate play by our Lucian. This is Lucian being a superstar in this fight. Now that I'm here, I still give him the shield, which actually doesn't save him. It's actually too late. That additional magic for resistance wasn't enough. I throw out the Q. And so what is important to notice, though, is I threw out the Q and it hit Nautilus. So I auto-attack Xerath. Because both of them are started at this point. So even though Xerath's about to probably die, and it's good to auto-attack him already just because of that, thanks to all the damage that came out from Jarvan the Fourth's ultimate here, this was also good just to start the procs on as many people around here as possible. Now we just got to focus down Xerath. He does have barrier this game, so he pops that and flashes out of the ultimate. Okay, that's good play by him to get the hell out of there. He really needed to. So I'm just here trying to get as much damage out as possible. We do kill that Nautilus. And Lee Sin, the character model, was hiding a little bit behind Jarvan, but he was on top of us. I'm just auto-attacking as much as possible. There's nowhere to run because they were still all trapped by Jarvan's ultimate. Now, right here, Jarvan's out of mana, and Jarvan actually kind of needs his mana to do things. So, this is a precarious situation. Xerath has the two procs already on him, so he's close to stun, but honestly, if we can trigger those two procs, he's dead probably just from the damage of triggering them. So it's not as much about the stun, it's just about how vulnerable we all are. I'm pretty low, but I'm definitely higher than Jarvan, how you can tell by his health bar is blinking red. It's like, oh god, get out of there, run! and mine's like, hey, you should probably play careful. So I need to make sure I get in front of him. Well, that stun, the only projectile that I could really block is that stun. And that probably isn't back up off cooldown for Xerath yet. So I should actually, instead of trying to block Xerath, or blocking Xerath, I should just make a beeline for him and try and Q or auto attack him to kill him as quickly as possible. So instead, I think I just try and hang with him here. And then I'm 6 off of that. So I have my ultimate. Now this is really bad, because he died. So let's go back and let's see when I hit that ultimate, or when I hit that level 6. Because it was during that fight, it was during those kills. And we gotta remember too, during all this, Xerath is level 8. So he can kill us pretty easily. Like, and he built damage. He's already got a back end of damage. He's got 4 kills already. He's scary. So we get in here. Both his summoners are down at this point. But we kill the Lee Sin. Now, if I make a beeline for him, something's possible. Instead, I run. Me and Jarvan are running. I start to come back because I realize, wow, he's really quite low. And if we can make something happen, it would be alright. And remember, very significantly, we have 3 minions here attacking him this whole time. Those guys put out a decent amount of damage. It's only 12 per attack, but over the course of this, they would put out a significant chunk of damage if I was in there fighting with them. So I needed to get in there and fight with them sooner. But I already forgot why we were watching that. Sorry, guys. We're going to go back one more time. Not yet. I'm still level 5. Still level 5. This kill, I hit level 6. Okay? I need to level this. Let's see how long it takes me to level that. It's only here I level it. So it took a significant amount of time. All that time I went from, I don't know, roughly here, this way, now I'm back here. Imagine if during that time I had walked even like this. Not even making the beeline for him like I should have. Because if I did, like, I can be autoing him, keeping those stacks alive on him, but also doing a significant chunk of damage on him. And then I'm in point blank range. If I use my ultimate, I'll kill him with my ultimate's damage. Like, it's nothing, but he's got no health, so it's enough. So even if I had gone a more defensive route like this, and still had to rely on my ultimate hitting, my ultimate has a pretty large range, so I could hit it. But instead, I'm so far away that I have to try and hit this, and it's too late. He's already thrown it out. He's got his kill. He's leaving, and it's done. So I recognize that and run away. Fortunately, I hit that, and I do have to flash. So what all that amounted to, that one wasn't as much about positional awareness, but it was about awareness because I was hitting 6. And then once I hit 6, it was positional awareness because I wasn't reacting to that properly. Even if it was going to take me an extra half a second to level it like it did, I should have been walking in the proper direction to be aggressive. And that was a dead Xerath. So let's review what I cost us. A heal. A kill. And assuming none of these things stacked multiplicatively, which they all do. I cost us a heal. Cost us a kill. Cost us a death, because J4 wouldn't have died. Cost us another kill, because Xerath would have died. Those first 2 things were off of the Nautilus. And then it cost us my flash as well. That's a lot. That is a lot of things that could have been improved upon. And even though this fight ends up being even for us, actually in our favor, because we killed Caitlyn earlier, she's already respawned. So it was a 3-for-2. It could have been so much better. It could have been so much better. And then we have Hero Lux. For those of you who weren't watching the stream, I was intentionally trying to keep backing early to save this point. Then we have Hero Lux coming in and just sniping him. So it gets super worth. by the end of all this, because it becomes a 4-for-2. So definitely worth it. Definitely an overall fine execution. Just according to those statistics, better than where I'm currently at was my play, because we came out so far ahead. But I could have done so much better. I could have done so much better during that fight. Three deaths, actually, and 2 summoner spells worth of better is what I could have done during that fight. So, I mean, again, just imagine if we had that much just sitting around ethereally right here. Somehow that would equate to Caitlyn being dead. Lux could have gone back to lane and been shoving her lane out to create pressure on mid lane to get some free damage on this turret, get all this farm she's missing. We wouldn't have needed her. Or again, she could have gone like through here and tried to like catch Caitlyn off guard and kill Caitlyn. Instead, she had to clean up what I couldn't clean up for her. So, you know, there's just many, many missed opportunities there because my positional awareness wasn't as high as it could have been. But, you know, that happens. That was the first major play. I appreciate you all giving me a little extra time to delve into that one. And I think you can see that it was an important one. You know, it really did matter. It made quite a difference. And it was a play where a lot of people died. So it was a very significant play for a number of reasons around the map and in this game. So, Caitlyn's coming up here. I think we only saw her once she showed here. Lux is just a god in hitting that on both of them. Unfortunately, she still dies. It's too bad. But seeing that, I react, okay, let's just shove this in as quickly as possible. I burned the stacks off. And then once they're missing for a little while, okay, they're not staying mid trying to shove mid, so let me just go forward, get some vision out of the fog of war here. I land a nice Q on a Nautilus, but nothing really comes of it. It's fine. Caitlyn's right behind him. It's possible that if during that, when Caitlyn was walking with him through here, if instead of being so far back going around here, if I was instead around here, we might have been able to get a nice engagement onto them, because this is always a very risky path to get back to lane, because these minions aggro to you, but these ones don't aggro to us, right? So that's a very tricky fight to hold properly. And there might have been a missed opportunity there, but I'm not going to sweat it that much. That one seemed like it was fairly minor. Okay, so seeing Lucian go in and try and get the extra shots off, he started that with the damage. Caitlyn's going to theoretically be able to get the damage on the way back out to answer him. So I need to get in there and stop that as much as possible. So I dive right in. Seems all right so far. Nautilus going and trying to keep the damage following up and keep the engagement going in their favor, get off some of his CC. But my passive stacks up on him. And we end up trading evenly there. We maybe could have got a little bit more damage on Nautilus on the way out, but we actually trade a little bit favorably there. Lucian and Caitlyn both use the health pot, so that kind of equalizes. Lucian steps forward again to get that piercing light. So my reaction time was late. Let's actually analyze that. Idiot raptor. Raptors are like this camp in the game that you can get. Anyways, so right here. I can already tell, just from him stepping forward aggressively like that, he's not going for this last hit. You know he's not going for that last hit. Why would he step forward, further putting himself out of position, if he was going for that last hit? So he's not going for that last hit. So what is he doing? He's going in, getting in range to get his Q off on Caitlyn. That's what he's doing. So what I need to do immediately right here is I need to jump to him and then try and get my Q off on Caitlyn. Because if I can get that Q before he gets his double shot off, then she's at 3 stacks and she's in a lot of danger. And instead of trying to kite back and return damage, which she has double buffs, so her kite hurts. this is why I was playing so far back. I don't think it's wrong to play pretty far back when she has double buffs like that and a level advantage. But seeing him step forward like this, and he had just done that in the last play. He got the Q off on her, and like that was what initiated that previous play. I got to see that coming. So I need to respond immediately. Instead, I just sort of walk. I think it's over, but of course he's going to try and get the double shots off. So I'm, again, wasting time. I could already be here, let alone if I jump to him. If I had jumped to him from, I think, in that range, I could just jump straight to him. Then I could have walked probably to here by now and put up my shield. So any damage she returns at this point would have been 100% mitigated by me. And then we would have won that trade. So that critical shot would have been negated. We possibly could have put her in stun range. And her Q wouldn't... the positioning would have been changed. I might have still had my E up, my giant shield up, to block that Q. So we would have been a lot better for that trade. And this is an extended skirmish there. So the way that finally works out is about even. But we, if I think that does come back to positional awareness. If I had used my E back then, we could have come out ahead of that trade. You know, but I wasn't positioning fully properly there. I was playing back further. When my ADC goes in, I need to support him. I need to be there fighting in the thick of it, for better or for worse. So we see that Lux and Jarvan are trying to come. So I'm stepping a little bit further forward there. Okay, they're backing off. They must have a ward or something. We can at least take Dragon. So I'm going forward there. I don't immediately turn on Lawless. One, because Lucian's not here. He's going to be slowed down by the minions just wanting to get those last hits on his way. But also, like, he's just far away. So I don't immediately turn on to Nautilus. And I instead prioritize trying to get the ward in this brush, which I think is the right thing to do because we want to establish vision over here to make sure nothing sneaky's happening with Caitlyn, like trying to E into this bush or something funky like that. And once I do establish that, then I just turn and go towards Dragon. I leave Lucian alone, but that means I'm here at the center of the action. Now that was a perfect jump to block. Jump back. As you can see, we can get that dragon, but it's just an ocean dragon. It just gives bonus regeneration. It's not nearly as valuable as some of the other dragons, so it's not that amazing that we get this dragon. Certainly helps. Certainly will take it. Right there. See how I jumped to her and just tanked that? Just took it for her? So she's fine. She's freed up. She doesn't take the damage. She isn't stunned. I'm a lot tankier. I have a lot more health. So any follow-up damage that's coming my way, one, they're not going to want to even throw at me because, whatever, it's just Braum, who cares. But two, it's going to be way less effective. So if they do throw it at me, Lux is still going to be around. I'm still going to be around because they're only going to take out a certain chunk of my health to where I could still do stuff. Lux, if she took all that, she's got to run. So that was a really good play. And I emphasize that enough because, oh, that was an amazing play, but because that was good positional awareness. And that's what I've been struggling with so far in this episode, is positional awareness. So I do get out of the shot there. I take Caitlyn's Q on the way out, but that's fine. And I'm running away. We're just getting out of here because I'm trying to get out of here because I took some damage because I did face tank that. So I don't really want to deal with this, but I will come in. I'll get the stack off on this cannon minion. That gives me a little extra regen. Good. But now I want to go back. I see that the fight is still happening. Lux is here, and we can see from this ward that two of them are there. So I'm like, okay, well, I gotta go answer that. I gotta be here to back her up. As soon as I see that they are this far out, I'm kind of debating right now whether or not I should just go back to Lucian, or I should still try and wrap around. I do make the right decision to continue. Actually, no, I remember I was debating that, but that was after I made the decision. Let me show you guys where I made that decision. So I'm walking right here. See where that ping is? It's like, no, I'm going. I'm chasing them. We're going to pincer them. What's either going to happen is one of two things, because I see J4 is out of their vision, right? They don't know Jarvan's here. They probably know that, or they do for sure know that I'm coming, because I saw this ward get placed down. They were thrown down at the same time. Unfortunately, again, the timers are broken, but you can just tell from the little white bar that they were thrown down at the same time. So I know this is ward. I know they see me coming, but Lux is the real prize. Lux can be killed much more easily than I can, and I can just turn away. They are chasing her. She's just getting as far away as possible. So any sort of gap close or catch they get on her, it's free. For me, I have opportunities to get away. Lux has very low positional repositioning capabilities. None of her abilities give her movement, move speed. Mine, I have one that gives me a huge gap close, or gap creator in this case. So I'm probably fine. Lux, maybe not as much. So she lands that binding on Xerath. Belisen jumps to this ward, and now all of a sudden he's in range. So they still don't see me, right? But here I am. So I'm trying to stay out of vision, right? Just out of vision if possible. Now, unfortunately, I didn't know this ward was here. I didn't know that ward was there. I don't know. Maybe it was placed when we were at Dragon, so I should have known. I didn't know, okay? Just trust me, I didn't know. So, my stutter stepping like this might have actually given this away if they were super aware of my stutter stepping and what that could possibly mean. But it could easily be misinterpreted as me just wanting to go back to Lucian and be bought. Luckily, Lucian shoved this in, so they aren't free to try and come upriver and answer this action. But Jarvan's in this bush. He's preparing for Lee Sin to go in on Lux, and then he'll be there to answer and back her up. So I'm trying to stay back out of vision as much as possible. Again, you know. But I'm trying to stay out of vision until Lee Sin commits onto Lux. And then Jarvan will probably be able to keep her alive long enough and keep Lee Sin busy enough to where by the time Xerath is becoming relevant, I'm wrapping around and becoming relevant, and now they're all, let me actually illustrate that. I'll be probably around here, and Xerath will have moved to here. Lee Sin will have gone on to Lux, both of them will be in this area, and Jarvan will have come in on the flank. So now we'll have, I can't really use different colors because they don't show up well on the stream. But we'll have 1, 2, 3 people in the engagement where they'll have one who's already in a 2v1 situation and one that can make that evened up as a 2v2, but then I'm free to come around here, follow it, and now they're all stuck in this encirclement where they have this. The only way out is through here. And Lux can kind of, since she has abilities that she can cast over this wall, Lux being in this position kind of makes this a dangerous route to walk through. So they really want to go back this way, which is why my being here is so important, because it cuts off this part of the map. So let's go forward in time here. This is exactly what happens. Lee Sin doesn't actually get the Q off. Now he throws it. But even though he misses it, he's already so deep, because Jarvan still hasn't showed himself. He was really letting Lux, like, be there as that juicy bait as long as possible. And then as he sees that Lee Sin mixes the Q, he can wait even longer, because now Lee Sin can't jump to Lux and immediately be on top of her. He has to walk to her. And Lux has more time for her cooldowns to come back up. She can throw out her shield to dodge some additional damage, which is exactly what happens right here. As soon as he's in range, she already has her shield up, so she's blocking some of that damage. And now is when she's going to actually start taking damage from Lee Sin. Now Xerath has entered range to start dealing damage. And who's that in the corner? Who's that dashing man in the corner coming around? I do believe it is Broom! Broom is here for you, but not yet. Because first, Jarvan's got to come out and make his presence known to the world here. So right here, Jarvan comes out. He goes straight on to Xerath. Xerath is a lot less tanky than Lee Sin. Not so much because he's a little bit higher level. It's early on in the game to where Lee Sin hasn't built his tank items yet. But Xerath definitely still is a squishier target. He has a lot less resistance. So Jarvan's going to try and just blow him up. You see all these beautiful flowers. That's from the additional move speed being popped by the Yomu's Ghost Blade here. So Jarvan's going to, since he's moving faster, he's going to stick to this Xerath. And he's going to deal a lot of damage just by auto-attacking him. And now, here I am behind. Lux also took barrier, so she pops barrier right now to try and block the damage from this Q. She actually winds up sidestepping it, I think. So she didn't even really need to do that. But regardless, even if that had hit her, it probably wouldn't have gotten through all of her shield there. So Lee Sin could have auto-attacked her once. And now look at their positioning. There's a Lux. There's a J4. There's a me. Broom. And here they are. They've got one route out. And it's here. Behind a minion line. Next to our turret. That's not where they want to go. That's their only route out now. If Xerath tries to wrap around here, even, and hug the wall, I'm going to be there to stop them. And they know because there's a ward right there. So they know that they got to go. They got to fight. They got to all in on Lux. They got to kill Lux. They got to all in on Jarvan. They got to kill Jarvan. And then I have to retreat because I don't do damage and I can't finish them off. That's the game plan, roughly speaking, for them if they want to turn this into a positive situation. But the very first step in that game plan just used her barrier. So she's got a whole bunch of health now that you got to work through. So this is bad news for them. Jarvan's in here. Lux is staying plenty far back. I jump into Jarvan to try and get these stacks started as much as possible. Unfortunately, I miss an opportunity there. So let's watch this. Lux, gotcha! When I jump in, I should auto-attack Xerath to start this going. Or I should immediately Q, right? I walk in, I put the shield forward just to block any damage coming out of Xerath that I can. If he tries to throw out a stun, maybe I can block it from going to Lux, maybe I can block it from going to Jarvan, that's fine. But the most important thing is to auto-attack him right here. Auto-attack Lee Sin right here. Get those auto-attack stacks started. Unfortunately, I don't. And then I try and throw out the Q. Now I throw it out this way. This isn't as bad as it looks, right? Because it looks like I just missed hugely. If Lee Sin wants to get out, he's got to go this way. Now, since we're all here, and he's cut off from Xerath, this isn't an option. He can't cross this. This is an option. But he's going to take a lot of damage from J4. So he elects to go this way. Now, if he had gone this way, which I actually would purport to you to be the better option, this would have hit him. So it's no longer the better option. He has to go this way. But why do I do that? Why is that a good thing? Because Lucian, since, remember, Nautilus and Caitlyn were dealing with this minion wave over here, they're going to be way slower to rotate to this fight up through this path than Lucian, who was done. All his minions that he had to kill were dead. So he's already rotating way sooner, and he's going to be here sooner. So because of that, this part of the map is ours. And you see that. Even though Nautilus tried to match him and did a pretty good job of it, one, killing this pink ward, or this red ward, is tasty. Nautilus might just kill this red ward and not do anything. And be like, listen, I'm sorry, you're dead. You got to get out on your own power or perform a miracle because I'm not going to be here to help you. But Lucian's coming. Lucian's going to come up here. It's too late for Nautilus to do anything about this. Unless Nautilus wants to fight. In which case, Caitlyn's still way over here. This is not a trade that Nautilus should be making, right? But he has to because it's trying to keep Lee Sin busy. So in doing so, he starts a fight that he knows he's going to lose. And he winds up dying for it, right? Does he? No, he doesn't, actually. Wow. So, amazingly, the heal saves him when he gets out. He should have died there. I guess he shouldn't have, but he came really close. And he should have come at least that close, if not dying. So he's lucky to make it out alive there. But let's jump back to where the primary action is going. Because all that happens, remember, because this is all the cutoff Lee Sin. So we're back in here. Let's watch Lee Sin. He has to go this way now. So I throw my ultimate out. I land it, knock him up, toasted. He was throwing down his ward to try and jump to it, and then he could be out of here. That's his only option if he doesn't go this way and try and hop to this ward, is to walk down here and jump to this, and then use this wall advantage that he creates by jumping here to get out. But that's why I don't hesitate. I ult him, I knock him up. He gets knocked up by Jarvan. He gets stunned by my passive. He's done. So at this point, I rotate back mid. I think there's three of us here, so it's good to create this pressure here. It's good to get my stacks off, which I no doubt have probably built up during all this. It looks like there's only one floating around me at this time. But I wasn't considering Lucian, right? I was thinking this would have been fine on its own. Luckily, Jarvan's watching. And, you know, I do quickly remedy this by coming back, right? Let's see how far I walk. I only walk about from here to there. That's pretty far, though, right? So let's remember, I walked from here to there, roughly. If I had instead spent that time walking to here, I would be here already. If I'm here right now, I can jump to Lucian now. Right now I jump to Lucian. I'm in range. Nautilus might have still flashed away there. I could have blocked this. Lucian would be higher health. Now, he still would have taken some damage. No, because that Q would have been blocked by my shield was on cooldown. So he still would have taken some damage there. But that would have deterred Caitlyn from just going all in on him and started stacks on Caitlyn. Even if it hadn't deterred her, right? She would have had stacks going. She would have been losing health. I would be already be on top of her like this. But she would be way, way more vulnerable right now. Now, again, Lux is a god. So she snipes him because she is OP. And luckily, she's far forward enough to where it still didn't matter. And they wind up dying. And we get the kill. Now, again, just because it's working out doesn't mean I played it perfectly. I did not play it perfectly. And because of a lack of positional awareness, I made a lot of poor rotational choices there and deciding when to go back bot towards the end. I wasn't positionally aware of myself in relation to the enemy to start stacking an auto attack off on Xerath or on Lee Sin during that last section of the fight. When we were all over here in this area. But we still end up working out for the better in that. I hang out in that bush because I think, okay, he clearly doesn't have vision. Let's pause it right here because a whole bunch of stuff is happening. So I hang out in this bush because the way he was pathing towards Lux, it seemed clear to me he didn't have vision. So I let him go in. As soon as he does, I jump to Lux. We get the kill. Great. 3v2. Our Jarvan's low, roughly 2v2, but with 2v2 and a guy who's just a giant minion even, effectively at this point, we're going to win that. So, after taking a little bit of extra damage, I'm like, okay, we're not so much going to win it anymore. Let's just back out. Let's take that free kill. Walk away. I was going to ward this bush. I still have Lux throw that down, so I instead throw a ward here, and then I back. Good. Overall, some mistakes, some positional errors made, some time wasted looking at the shop thinking, what should I buy this game? Brum is a window shopper, yes. But overall, not the worst play. We ended up doing okay from what we come out. We came out a little bit ahead. In part, thanks so much to Lux's amazing play. She dodged a lot of really clutch shots. That's great. So again, I'm trying to bait out that hook. Now that the minions are here tanking it, I don't want to do that anymore. I react pretty quickly to this. And I do wind up tanking the net. Which the net's damage isn't the problem, but when you get hit by the net, it then enables her to get a headshot off, which critically strikes. It's an auto attack that has additional range and critically strikes. So I want to make sure I tank that for him. I also do block her Q and that auto attack. And then that's a beautiful ultimate from my part. I'm going to stroke my ego a little bit there. It forces Caitlyn to flash. It does two things, right? It forces Caitlyn to flash, number one. It gets some crowd control onto Nautilus, whose cooldown is up on his flash, which we may or may not have been aware of. but so it, if she flashes here to stay in the skirmish, we've already got these stacks off to where we can stun him. And Lucian's very good at skirmish fighting like that, just dodging around a short enclosed area. So we might win that trade pretty handedly. If she flashes away like this, she's for sure safe, but now Nautilus is on his own. He's in a lot of danger. So we just turn, we immediately proc that stun. He throws out his ultimate to try and do what he can on his way out, but even with that, there's not much he can do. Now I exhaust here. I'm not sure that was the best time to exhaust. We end up being okay. We got the kill there. A better time to exhaust would be probably as soon as we know he's dead. Like right here. Anytime now. Right here. Best time to exhaust. So I'm a little slow on that. It's okay. We do end up getting that. He gets that last auto and then is like probably not even aware he's going to get that auto off. Just immediately trying to dash in to get that last double shot. But he got it. If I had exhausted her slightly sooner, that wouldn't have been such a max range final shot, max range final auto attack that got her. It would have been a lot easier. He wouldn't have had to dash forward. He would have had additional mana from not having to dash. He wouldn't have tanked that turret shot, which he's fine because he has lifesteal built because he's going Blade of the Rune King because that's what everyone does these days. But again, some mispositioning on my part. Not as much of the awareness, but a little bit because Nautilus, he needs to... we took some free turret shots there. Never mind that. It's a little bit about positional awareness, again, because Nautilus, as soon as he was dead because of his positioning, I should have been aware of that, and I should have turned my entire focus onto Caitlyn. I think I split my focus for too long. And if I was more aware of his positioning in relation to our evolution, I could have adjusted my play to be more properly focused on Caitlyn. But it wasn't a big enough error to make the difference, so we end up coming out ahead there. The gold difference is actually becoming quite stark, even though the kill difference doesn't look so stark. It's definitely a sizable lead for us, but 6k. That's quite a lead for us, you know. So that's pretty good. I completed my locket. Let's analyze a couple things here really quick. I completed a locket just because I wanted to give some mixed resistance to everybody. I wanted to give a shield to everybody so they sustain longer because... since we're ahead, if I can just keep the thing going, the fight going longer, we'll be alright. So giving a shield to everybody on our team, extending the duration of a fight, is advantageous to us. So it's a good time to go lock it. Also, even though this is a more physical damage heavy team, that Xerath is really fed. He is the main threat on their team right now. So getting some a strong influx of magic resistance now for me is good because it'll mitigate that huge power spike Xerath is having right now when he's ahead of everyone else comparatively. As the game goes forward and that power spike sort of evens out with the rest of his team, the armor is going to become more relevant. So right now is the time to prioritize getting that magic resistance heavy item as opposed to the armor heavy items that come later. So that's fine. I don't think there's... that it's the best use of my time to be here trying to create pressure in this lane. Especially, this was just an awareness fault on my end. I didn't realize that this turret was down. I honestly did think that was up. So trying to push that into a turret that's right here to deny the experience and gold is fine. But since this turret wasn't up, I'm not really doing anything aside from picking up the gold for myself from killing the enemy minions, which is, it's fine. But, you know, I could have been going top. I could have been throwing down wards in this part of the map, which I get a nice ward here on my way out, whatever. Lucian gets that for me, perfect. I was actually going to use it to sweep bear or dragon pit, but that's fine. It's good to start the scuttle crab, because as you saw, the dragon just spawned, and we're probably going to contest it because we have good vision around it and we have good control of this wave. So the fight's starting up. The minion line has stopped here, so we're actually going to try and push it out one more time, which I think we do safely. Yeah, we see Nautilus is there. We have pretty good vision. They did kill this. They did sweep it out and kill it. So we've lost a little bit of our vision control, so I reestablish that by throwing down a ward here. I was a little wary because I knew Nautilus was there. I jump in, get into the thick of the fight, throw up my shield just in case if anything's going to come out. I don't know exactly what I was expecting. Maybe the stun from Xerath could come out. Better safe than sorry, I suppose. Not a little bit of waste of mana, a little bit of waste of a cooldown, but it's fine, why not? We actually almost don't get that dragon. and that was a good dodge to know that, okay, it spawned the fruit that will heal me, so he's probably going to target there, so I juked a little bit away from it. That was good. That was good positioning. Luckily, we did get that dragon. That would have been unfortunate to have that stolen away. I'm hanging out here with Lucian to get those last stacks off before I go back. Then I see people rotate down, so we decide to try and get this turret. Now, during this time, I'm actually going to back up right now. During this turret fight, so we've got a substantial wave. We can probably get this turret with four of us here, right? That's great. That's great. We can do that. Unfortunately, Renekton just got a kill, so he's free to teleport, except he doesn't have teleport, so that's fine for us. But he's going to be split-pushing, creating pressure, trying to answer on the other side of the map. We split-push faster than Renekton does because we're four people and he's one. So we can probably get this and not be too punished by that split-push. At a certain point, when do you, as four, turn and kill this Nautilus under the turret? Well, we really want to get this turret, so we should focus first, let Lux get a little bit more in range to where she could probably auto-attack the turret, then maybe turn onto Nautilus. So let's see what happens. Right now, Lux is in range, but Xerath has come. The equation's gotten a little bit dicier for us if we turn to dive somebody, especially Nautilus, who is tanky. One of his abilities that he's maxing first, or second rather, just gives him an additional shield. So he's even more tanky than he looks right now, which he looks plenty tanky as is. It might be best just to focus this, but this is a lot of wave clear coming in. So we might even need to back off. We'll see. Now Lux lands the binding. So that's not the worst way to engage. We do turn on them. So, I think it's that binding where I decide, okay, you know what? I'll start this off. I'll throw the Q on him. Because I don't know if that's necessarily the optimal play right there. But if Lux threw an ability and it landed, that's going to be the go button for most everyone else on the team. And if we're hitting the go button, I want the turret to be attacking me. My health pool is the least relevant because I'm the support here. My abilities aren't nearly as impactful as theirs are, and they need to stay alive because they output damage much more than I do. So I can afford to tank the turret. So I throw out my Q to draw the turret's aggression onto me, and then we're free to start fighting. Lucian procs the stun. Beautiful. I'm standing here just soaking it up for extra long, even when we got the kill. I want to make sure there's no, like, burn from the red buff on Lucian that, like, aggroes to him. So I take one more shot, and then I drop the aggro. That's pretty good positioning. It was fairly good awareness, too. That's just unfortunate. Yeah, he gets the question mark ping for that from somebody on our team. He meant to ult this way to try and get damage onto Xerath. But that's fine, whatever. We're here for my mistakes, right? This was a good moment for me because I had that positional awareness to know, look, I can just point blank Q Nautilus and take that turret aggro onto myself. Why not? Let's just do it. We're far enough ahead, we can probably make it happen. So that was a good, I think, example of proper positional awareness and how I could have capitalized on, not how I could have capitalized on the play and made something happen, but how I did. So I'm rotating mid. I'm not quite sure where, whether or not we would be able to bring those minions in, so we decided to rotate back. And then we can't really get anything because Renekton's there now too. So I'm thinking, alright, let's push this wave out and then start setting up Baron. Maybe not necessarily start it, but let's set up some vision. Try and deny some of their vision. All good. I do wind up finding a ward there. Fabulous. Start the scuttle. I think I actually didn't have any wards available at this time, so I wasn't able to throw down any wards. But good. You know, we swept that out. That allows us to get a pick on Nautilus here. I jump forward, so I'm able to not only tank that stun from Xerath, but able to shoot my Q off, so Lucian's autos are stacking and getting the stun off. It's wonderful. Lux is just being her typical Lux self, as she was this game. She gets the stun off, or the ultimate off, and kills him. Great. I'm not sure where Xerath is ulting right now, to be honest. I think he was just trying to get damage on Lux, and he does get a fair amount down. So she's chipped pretty hard. It makes going for a turret a lot less viable. We've got a huge wave coming in top, so rotating here might have been the better play. I'm actually the one pinging out to go to Baron, and I'm just thinking, like, look, we got a 4v5, let's just go for gold and get the Baron. This probably would have been the safer play, rotating up here instead, but we do end up going to Baron. I think having Gnar up there and leaving Gnar there, not pulling Gnar down to be with us and at the Baron, is good because it splits their focus, right? Are they going to jump forward into the darkness? Because this is their vision. Are they going to go into the fog of war to a team that might be waiting to bushwhack them, all hiding in here looking to get another pick? Because remember, that's what we just did to Nautilus. We just waited and killed them from fog of war. So are they going to run into fog of war again to see if we're doing Baron? Or are they going to go try and stop the Gnar they know is hitting this turret, they know is trying to take this inner turret down? So, you know, that's not a bad play. The worst play. I again think it probably was higher percentage to go get that turret together as a team, then rotate back here, or then try and get a fight. I've got good positioning there to try and soak up the shield from Lux. I think this is where a mistake happens for me this game. Yeah, this is a bad moment. So I'm watching Lee Sin, right? I'm thinking, okay, maybe I can get a Q out onto him. Maybe I can try and soak his Q when he throws out his Q to try and jump, and I can like flash over here to bring him back out of the pit, make sure he doesn't get in there, try and smite steal. Throw down some extra resistance for Jarvan. I activate my locket. I realize, whoa, she's very low. But then I see how low she gets him. And at this point, I've just only been watching Lux and Lee Sin. And you'll actually note, I think you all see what's coming here. But you'll actually be able to tell right now when I'm going here. When he goes in on her like that, I'm like, oh no. And I kind of go towards her to try and throw out a Q, and I'm like, I gotta get out of here. But then I turn back. Because she has got him, I was like, oh no, we're fine. But then I die. And do you know why I died? Chat, I will give a mod ship to anyone who can predict this. That's right, it's because of my positional awareness, I wasn't aware that I was the one tanking the Baron, because I was too focused on the Sin. That winds up being a favorable trade for us. Since they trade flashes, he winds up getting the kill again. But in the meantime, I'm dead. I'm over there dead. And if I was alive, not only would it have been helpful just to have another person there to create more pressure, but I would be... if that had been something that after that fight, they had all stayed on Baron and taken Baron, I wouldn't have had Baron buff. So I would have both died and cost us Baron buff. So even though it's not what happened, it could have been that bad to where I wouldn't be wearing Baron. So, you know, that's an important play to not make an error on in that way. Just dying for free to Baron. It's silly. It's just a silly mistake that happens sometimes. And you should never let that happen. But again, it comes back to the positional awareness problem that I'm having. So it's just another symptom of that. It's a more comical and obvious symptom. This Lux was just on point this game. The light will guide you to double kills all day. Snipes all day. I think it comes down to that positional awareness again. I am able to get that cannon minion. That's pretty good. We've got people up top, creating pressure. It's a while before our minions get here, so I'm trying to rotate top. Seeing this happen though, seeing this action here, instead of rotating top to attack this, what I should have done is before Lucian started his dash from right here, I should have jumped the wall to him, right? And then we could together be going over here and trying to kill these two guys, following up on Meganar. So I'm tunneling a little bit on this turret. I'm not as aware of my position in relation to Lucian, but because of a positional awareness problem, I'm not here to help out. Lucian goes very low from that. He doesn't wind up dying, I don't think, but he does go very low. And Gnar has to be the tank. And Gnar's running out of health, so I do wind up getting here in time to throw down the locket to keep Gnar plenty healthy. And then we juggle the aggro properly to where we're fine. But this all comes into play. I'm not emphasizing this just to nitpick myself. These health bars will matter. You guys will see momentarily here. Lucian wouldn't be this low. Because I would have given him a little bit of extra resistance when he was tanking those. And I would have helped us resolve the situation a lot faster. Same for J4. J4 wouldn't have had to been the one tanking it on the way back out to protect Lucian if I was there to tank instead. I'm just sitting full health. I'm not even regening. Like, I'm at 100% full health. Like, I'm wasting potential regen. And Gnar, who had to tank most of that, wouldn't have almost died. And also, I wouldn't have had to burn my locket, right? So, all these people that are blinking red and darn near, and this cooldown I have on this item right now, wouldn't have been the case. Now, we haven't been punished yet, but here's where the punish starts to happen. Gnar has to flash there. Wouldn't have had to flash there. Now, just imagine. If Gnar was so much higher health, I mean, again, first of all, just kudos to Lux to get a good play there and get the kill. But imagine, if Gnar had had so much higher health, he wouldn't have had to flash defensively there and make Lux tank it, so now she's into the blinking red too. If he could have tanked that and just fought him, and then Lux could have been a ranged, like, caster support damage outputter. That was a lot of words, but... if she could have been playing her role as a ranged DPS mage instead of having to support Gnar by tanking, then she wouldn't have been this low. Again, not punished yet, but we've got this inhib. We're rotating up here to support them and back them up. Now we're going to focus this. Good positional awareness to block that. Look at how low they are. They've got it back. It's possible with these minions coming in that we could be on these turrets here. Or on the next wave, we could escort them up here, be on these turrets here, trying in the game. That's good. That is good. Lux's ult for once actually doesn't snipe someone only because we kill them too quickly. But again, good positional awareness there. That was a money cue. Good positional awareness of the minions and myself in relation to this. Because this is, remember, this is a structure that has a boundary. These minions can't, even if they're aggroing to us like that, they can't aggro straight like this. So I can cue through the structure because it doesn't enter, it doesn't collide with that. It only hits enemies, the creeps or the champions. So I can just queue right over, knowing this is here and knowing that it goes in a straight line. Just good positional awareness there. That's the kind of play should have been making all game long with Braum. It's because of that, and the boomerang hitting from Gnar, that Lucian feels confident enough to just get that and then dive in. Even though he's low, he's pretty low, it's because that stun was going to proc, it's because she already took so much damage, it was guaranteed to kill. Easy. But look at how low he is now. They're all so low. I mean, this is a game. I mean, again, looking now, Gnar has regened because he's Mega Gnar, but Lux had to go back to base, so we're only here as four. Lucian's blinking red. Jarvan's blinking red. This was a game won by a margin, you know? It may have seemed really strong in this end phase, but this was a marginal victory. And again, J4 almost dies there. We're focusing on this. Gnar's playing forward because he's the most tanked up. Lucian burns heal just to make sure they don't die. I don't think I was even in range for it. Just to make sure Jarvan doesn't die. And again, this makes it look easy now at the end, right? But this was a game won on the margins. I really do think, maybe not won because we had a large lead. We probably could have come back and ended it after we had respawned anyway, or backed off and like taken Baron and then, or like gone Dragon Baron, something like that. I think we could have won it regardless, but that was, being able to end it right here is a marginal thing, you know? And so oftentimes when you can't win a game off that slim of a margin, that's when you give the enemy an opportunity to come back. So again, it happened to work out. We happened to not be punished. We happened to have a Lux who was really good. We happened to have a Lucian that was really good. Not to not give kudos to Jarvan, but just in particular, they were the flashy ones that it was showcased a lot of. Jarvan's ults looked pretty flashy at times too, so Jarvan, pretty good. That's sad, little Poro. But I think at the end of the day, there shouldn't have even been debate about that ending, whether or not it was marginal. It shouldn't have been something that could even be questioned as marginal. That should have been an easy stomp, an easy closeout. And I don't think it was as easy as it made it look because the team felt a little defeated at the end there. I think it was a lot closer of being able to not be closed out. And I think that, again, I had a lot of opportunities throughout that game to, if I had had better positional awareness, to have made plays go a lot smoother, to have not missed out on so many opportunities, and to have saved us a lot of resources. All the summoner spells we had to burn to compensate for my polar positional awareness wouldn't have had been burned, and we could have instead used them offensively to make plays. And when you can make that turn from not using your summoner spells to compensate for mistakes defensively, which there's an art to doing that, and it's good that we were able to pull that off. That shows that we're all players that have a certain level of skill. That's great and all. But if we can make that turn to instead be using all those summoner spells offensively to make proactive plays instead of making reactive plays, That would be a lot helpful. That would have snowballed the game even faster. That would have closed it more decisively and quicker. And, you know, it just... Those margins. If the longer you let the game go on, the closer you let the lead be. You know, your lead. If you let it be smaller. Teams come back. People make mistakes. And I leave the door open for that when I have that poor positional awareness. So, even though, again... We had a really good scoreline aside from the shameful death execution to Baron. even though it looks pretty good, I think this was a gut check moment for when I just pick up a champion that I haven't played in a while and take him right into ranked. Some of those basic things like positional awareness, I'm going to be rusty at, and I'm going to be bad at, and I'm going to make mistakes on. I'm going to cost us resources, I'm going to miss out on opportunities, because I'm not going to have that positional awareness, because I'm not so used to the champion. I haven't been getting my practice in on them like I should, I haven't been getting used to their ranges and their abilities and their any sort of combos or how to set up and play throughout a team fight. Like, again, to use Braum as the example, how to auto properly to start the chain of stacks to get the eventual stun proc. There were a couple of times I wasn't getting that started properly. And the times where I did get that started properly were times when we made big plays. And swung plays that would have been decisively against us and made them even. You know, that's what you have to do. That's a very strong part of Braum's kit. I mean, people used to take Courage of the Colossus on him just because of that stun proc. You know, not because his ultimate can knock people up. You would rarely proc it out of that. You would sometimes, because you sometimes engage a fight out of that. But very oftentimes, you would be, I mean, entirely before you hit level 6, you would have to rely on getting that stun off to proc that keystone. And if you can only passively get a keystone to work for you, that's got to be a very powerful and reliable passive you have. And that's what Braum has. That's a lot of Braum's kit, is that stun. And a lot of being able to get that stun off is that positional awareness. You have to know where you are. You have to know where your enemies are. You have to know what the relation between you is and how to make the most out of that. How to minimize that gap when you want to start the chain. When the chain is already happening, how to minimize that gap to make sure that you're adding onto that chain that one extra auto attack that'll proc it. Or allow, in this case, Lucian to get his double shot off, and then he can proc it without having to then wait for another auto attack after. Little marginal things like that make a big difference. And again, this game looks pretty convincingly in our favor. I don't think it was. You know, I think this was a very losable game for us. If I had had any worse positional awareness, I think the scoreline would have not looked nearly as good as it looks right now. And I would have had a much harder time closing this game out. We would have had a much harder time closing this game out because of additional errors I could have been making. So, that's about it, though. I hope that's useful to you guys. Again, positional awareness is one of those things that people don't think about very often, or at least is easy to not think about too often. Unfortunately, Chernobyl, I am done for the day. Let me just bring it in here. But thank you. I appreciate all of you watching. Hopefully that was helpful to you. If you know anyone who's struggling with positional awareness or needs to brush up on some of these fundamentals and, you know, they have a good game, they get feeling all positive about, like, hey, I'm playing well, I know what I'm doing, I've got good fundamentals. Well, you know, you can always re-examine those replays. You can always find those areas for you to improve. And, you know, even though I had a good game, I had a lot of problems with those fundamentals. So, it's always good to bring it back. It's always good to remember to brush up and focus and pay attention to the marginal micro changes that you can make in the game to improve. And those will snowball your games. Those will make really big differences. So, you know, if you know anybody like that, or feel free to share the video with them. If you yourself benefited from that, you're somebody who that applies to, leave a like, leave a comment, let me know that it was helpful. All that good stuff. Thanks again for watching, and thank you, Twitch chat, for joining me live, giving me some feedback, letting me know which game you wanted to see us review today. Appreciate it. I'll see you guys tomorrow.